Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's Indians program on psychiatric rehabilitation. Today we'll be dealing with community-based rehabilitation. Today we have with us Dr. Sivakumar, who is additional professor of psychiatry in psychiatric rehabilitation services, NIMHANS, Bangalore. So over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, one and all. Thanks for the opportunity. So over the next half an hour, we will be discussing about the concept of community-based rehabilitation and give an overview of the work which has been done so far. According to the Mental Health Care Act, there needs to be a range of services which needs to be available at all government general hospitals. And one of this is community-based rehabilitation. The concept of community-based rehabilitation is actually old by about four decades. So it was first mentioned by the World Health Organization in its Alma Ata Declaration, where CBR was actually conceptualized as a way to give healthcare and rehab services to the community, especially for persons with disabilities. And in the year 2003, the World Health Organization expanded its ambit to include, apart from healthcare and rehab services, it also included general community development, equalization of opportunities, poverty reduction, and social inclusion. In the year 2005, the WHO urged everyone to promote and strengthen community-based rehabilitation programs. If you look at the Indian data, all of us are aware that there is a deficit of psychiatrists, nurses, psychologists, as well as psychiatric social workers in the country. And it is more alarming to look at the percentage of total health budget which is given for mental health expenditure. So for a lower income country, it is on an average 0.53. And the figure as per WHO for India is as low as 0.06. So this is actually much lower than low income country. It is more shocking if we look at how this 0.06 percentage of the total health budget is being spent. So mental health expenditure actually accounts for more than nearly 3/4 of the total mental health budget. The exact figure for India is not available, but if we are to extrapolate from the low-income countries, data which WHO Mental Health Atlas has given, about 0.06% of the total health budget, which is allotted for mental health, 3/4 of this, so nearly 0.04% is going to be used. So only a small proportion of it is actually used for other purposes. So India has about 43 mental hospitals. So this is going to be the approximate figure. So we are about the data from the National Mental Health Survey, which gives a lifetime prevalence of 13.7 and current prevalence of 10.6%. And it is more alarming to look at the mental health gap, both for common mental disorders as well as severe mental disorders. The figure is about 70-85% for both these. And 85% seek treatment from private sector. And this expenditure is said to drive families to economic crisis. What is the reason for this treatment gap? One is demand-side barrier in terms of the patients and the family members not being aware about mental illness, that treatment is effective and is available, stigma. And there are supply-side barriers in terms of us not having enough mental health professionals to cater to this, mental health professionals being concentrated in the cities, and even the existing professionals, their services not being optimally utilized. And people also travel to long distances for tertiary care facilities, mainly because of poor quality of care. And if they were to seek treatment from private services, many people have to spend from their pocket because we do not have official mechanisms till now. And the National Mental Health Survey says that about families spend about 1,000 to 1,500 per month for availing care. This is out of the reach for many people who may be below the poverty line. So it is in this context that the World Health Organization gives the services organization pyramid. So if you look at this, there is the apex of the pyramid is where all the mental hospitals and tertiary care facilities actually come. So here, the frequency of need is low, while the cost is actually pretty high. And a huge proportion of this cost actually goes for paying the salaries of health professionals and for running the services. So if we come more closer to the ground, to the community level, there is a huge number of people who need these services, but the amount of money which is needed to offer these services is actually less. So the World Health Organization advises that we need to be spending a large amount of the budget which is available for towards the base of the pyramid, which means either primary care services or for informal care and for self-care. So this is likely to help us reach a large part of the population at cost-effective means. So the World Health Organization has come up with this community-based rehab guidelines in 2010. So they approach the needs in five different domains. We will be coming back to the slide again. So please focus on the main domains, which includes health, education, livelihood, social, as well as empowerment domains. And according to the World Health Organization, community-based rehabilitation is multisectoral. I think it will be clear from the previous slide where we spoke about other domains apart from health, including education, livelihood, social, and empowerment. So we need experts from these different fields. That is why it is multisectoral. And why it is bottom-up is it is not decided by the people who are implementing the program. Rather, we try to understand the needs of the people whom we are trying to serve. So that is why it is called as a bottom-up approach. And the World Health Organization also makes a difference between what is a community-based rehabilitation project and what is a community-based rehabilitation program. A CBR project is likely to be short-term, small in scale. It can focus on a specific outcome. Say, for example, a CBR project can focus that I will try to identify persons with schizophrenia or bipolar disorder in a particular community and start them on antipsychotics. So a CBR project will focus only on one specific domain, and it can have a specific start as well as end date. Say, for example, about 2 to 3 years. We try to go to a particular district, start mental health services, and offer treatment for all persons with severe mental illness for about 2 to 3 years. But if you look at a community-based rehabilitation program, it is large in scale, it is going to be long-term, and it is going to be more complex. Usually, programs start as a community-based rehabilitation project. Over a period of time, other components get added in, and there is going to be no set completion date over here. Good examples of community-based rehabilitation programs are the ones run by Yellamuthu Trust in Madurai. So they started their community-based rehab program nearly 2 decades ago. And over a period of time, they have diversified from health domain to livelihood, education, as well as social domain also. So we will be discussing some of these in greater detail towards as we progress further in the presentation. So who are the stakeholders in community-based rehabilitation? The most important stakeholder is the community itself. So if you look at this particular figure, which is taken by the from the WHO CBR guidelines, so you look at the person with disability and the family. So we start with them. Then we go to the local community. Then we also approach the community leaders, teachers, health and workers. So in this case, it will involve the PHC medical office, group workers, the pharmacist, the village health at the taluk and district level, and finding is going to be decided by the national policy as well as by the political leadership as well as the media. And here we need to be clear about this sort of task shifting. Because when we go to the community and delivering services there, it's going to be a big issue in terms of all the trained professionals over there. So in task shifting, we try to take, when we start community-based rehabilitation programs, it is likely to be in an underprivileged community. It is important to take the community into confidence, but many a time the community members and especially persons with disability and mental illness may not be empowered in that particular community. So such programs are usually started by an NGO or by an outside agency. So among the first task is to go and then understand the needs of that particular community and try to cater to the needs. With time, the trust builds. We are also able to get other local stakeholders the particular program. And period of time, we may be able to particular community also. One of the challenges of we may not get trained professionals there. So what we may have to do is get whomsoever in that particular community, train them given task, handhold them so that they are able to do that particular work. So this concept is called as task shifting. Shifting can be the So this task shifting can be done with patients or with the family member or even the local community. Different organizations have taken a different role. there is this prominent organization called Mental Health Action Trust. So they involve community volunteers, neighbors of patients with mental illness in task shifting. So the neighbor actually becomes the case manager. They try to ensure that the person is on regular medication. They also try to help them with their basic needs, daily needs, getting rations. And when the person recovers, even putting a word to their friends and getting a job. So this is one model which is followed by Mental Health Action Trust in Calicut. MS Chelamuthu Trust in Madurai utilizes a different model. They try to utilize the caregivers of persons with mental illness who have been treated as their staff. Their rationale is they have a lived experience. They're able to understand the difficulties and they're able to reach out better. And even when staff are employed in the community-based rehabilitation program, it is desirable that we involve people from the local community, that they are aware about the local issues and are able to join with them. Like we have our ongoing community-based rehabilitation program in one of our taluks, which we'll be speaking about. There we've had a reasonable success in involving ASHA workers who are a part of that particular community. According to the World Health Organization, they speak about what is known as a CBR management cycle. So they advise that we start with a situation analysis where we go to the persons with mental illness and the family, try to understand their needs and then prioritize it. People may have different and multiple needs, but the community may not have the resources to cater to all the needs. So we again go and speak to the other stakeholders and inform them that these are the needs of the community and what is it that we can. So what happens is we may not be able to address all the needs, but we pick and choose certain domains which can be met with. Most commonly what happens is people need regular treatment and free medications. So the program we prioritize being regular treatment through mental health camps and ensuring that medications are available free of cost. So then we make a plan and then we implement it and then evaluate. So one of the crucial domains is in getting free medications. Again, different organizations follow different models. So in certain organizations, people run research projects. So they have research funds and medicines are purchased through it and it is offered free of cost. While in a second program, people may partner with the government, ensure that the DMHP medications are utilized for the community-based rehabilitation program and offer it free of cost. In the model run by Mental Health Action Trust Calicut, actually pool funds from the local volunteers. The psychiatrist tries to get some of these medications in bulk at retailer prices, like not at the fine income retailer, at distributor prices, they try to get it and then do that. There are certain organizations where the psychiatrist may be influential and may also be successful in getting certain free samples from pharma companies and then offer it free of cost for the community-based rehabilitation program. So it is a chain and then it's going to take a lot of time. And when we start a community-based rehabilitation program, people may have a lot of misgivings. So in Madurai, when they actually started a CBR program and wanted to run a mental health camp along with some facility in the village, initially the villagers had felt that it was providing general health facilities and they were happy. But the moment they realized that it was for mental health, they actually started protesting and people had a tough time in negotiating it. So they started with providing general health services and as a part of it, they provided certain mental health services. One of the tipping point was when the village leader's son actually had mental illness and was not on treatment. And when the program started catering to them, they found that the patient recovered and this helped in changing the attitude of the villagers and gradually the program could actually take root. So many a time, even though our intention is to help the community may have its own misgivings and they may not be ready. So this ongoing process of being and then interacting with the community, understanding their needs, winning over their confidence is the most crucial part. The second part is in ensuring that the staff do not lose its morale. And the third, most importantly, is to continue offering services so that people become better. And once people become better, that is the advertisement which the community actually needs. So we have already spoken about, maybe given some references of some of these programs, including NIMHANS cohort, which we have been running. In the next few slides, we will be speaking about our experience in Jaglore. So it is actually one of the newer programs which we have been running for the last 5 years. So we'll take you through this particular program and what we have actually been able to do. So Jaglore is a dry taluk, which every year is declared as drought hit. So it is in central Karnataka. So we have shown the location. So you will be able to see how this taluk looks. The first spell of rains are there. But generally what happens is the subsequent spell of rains do not happen. And this is a common sight. All the crops having grown in, because the second spell of rains have not come, everything wilting and then getting off to naught. So it has a population of about 1.7 lakhs. And there is no psychiatrist in this particular taluk. So people have to travel either 80 kilometers to the district headquarters or nearly about 300 kilometers to private health facilities or government health facilities to consult a psychiatrist. And there was poor awareness about mental illness when we actually started this program. And people, even those people who were aware, could actually not afford treatment. So we also need a rehabilitation need assessment of this particular population. When we went to people with mental illness as well as their family members, these were the needs. So the most important thing was they wanted the treatment to be given at the closest possible place because they were spending a lot of money and it was difficult for them to do that. Most people, they had to take loans to travel to avail this. And even in those people who had money, there were practical difficulties when the patient refused. For example, the person decompensated. And they could not get this person on the bus to do it. So at those times, they had to spend about 10,000, 15,000 hiring a total vehicle, tying up this person and then taking him to the facility to get treatment for this particular person. And even when people were well-maintained, they had to spend on an average about 10 to 15,000 for them to actually buy these medicines and then give it. And when the crops were failing every year and they were already in loans, this was a very big burden for people. And when we ask them about their education needs. So interestingly, a very small number of people actually came up with the need that they wanted education. So it was actually not the felt need of this particular population. For them, it was more a hand-to-mouth kind of an existence. People were more worried about their daily livelihood, daily food, and education was actually not a priority when assessed for this. Again, we need to be careful that all these needs depends on the population whom you actually ask. Say, for example, you come to urban Bangalore and you speak to people about education, it is pretty much likely that education is likely to be a felt need for many people. It may not be so in a deprived rural area. And when we asked about non-formal learning and even other education, so there were a lot of people who came with the need for learning some skills or even for getting some money for animal husbandry. We would like to highlight the need of one particular female whom we came across. So this lady, she was doing BBA and was the first female from her family to have actually gone to college. Unfortunately, she became psychotic and we had started her on medication and she became better. But the family felt that because she started studying, that was actually a stressor which led to this mental illness. And they were apprehensive that to allow her to continue studies. While this lady actually wanted to complete her education, she also wanted to take on higher studies and possibly take up a job in an urban area, which the family members were not okay with. So here, the need of this person is pretty different. So it is influenced by her aspirations, by her peer group. But the key barrier when it comes to education is actually not money. It actually is the cultural factor of the family and their own perception of why this illness actually came about. So these are issues which we need to tackle when we go to the rural areas. And the next domain, according to the World Health Organization CBR matrix, was about the livelihood domain. So here you can look at the various domains which come in, which include skill development, self-employment, wage employment, and financial services. So when we spoke to people about livelihood, especially on the area of social protection, interestingly, most of our people, they wanted social protection, that is disability pension. Please remember that they come from a deprived area and they want to optimally utilize any government service which is offered. So we also work here in urban Bangalore. So this particular finding was pretty surprising. In our urban clinics, many people are not aware about a disability certificate or about the concept of disability pension. While in the rural area, most people were aware that mental illness was a disability and people could get a disability pension. So which currently is about 600 rupees if it is 40 to 75%. If it is more than 75%, it is 1,400. So there is a clamor that people need about rupees 1,400. They do not want 600. So they want to know whether we can help them in getting that 1,400 pension. So people are aware about some of these schemes and they are actually pretty keen to do that. And a few people also come up with a need for wage employment, for a need in opening a bank account, even for skills development. So the government actually has schemes, especially in underdeveloped areas. Like all of you may be aware about the Skill India initiative of the government of India. Likewise, there are skilling initiatives which are run by the government. There are skilling initiatives which are run by the government, both for rural areas as well as urban areas. So they are mostly for unemployed youth. So it is not specifically for people with disability or mental illness. Again, the schemes for unemployed youth is something which people with mental illness can also utilize. They just need to show that they fall in that particular age group. They need to have an age proof. They need to go there, and the government has programs, short-term training programs or even long-term training programs which run under a corporate social responsibility, where people need not get any fees. Once they avail this particular programs, they get a training certificate. With this certificate, they become eligible for loans. Again, a lot of these schemes are on paper. So to actually ensure that these schemes run, we need to liaise with the banks, we need to run with different stakeholders, and we need to sensitize them about the needs, and they need to gain confidence that people will take these loans, their lives actually improve, and they actually repay. So that actually is the more difficult part, which requires multi-stakeholder input. We also went for the social needs, and here many people, they did address, ask for needs about relationship, recreation, leisure, and then justice, etc. Interestingly, you will find that the figures here are pretty less. So the biggest need is for health. The next biggest need was for disability certification and pension. The other needs were actually expressed only by 10 to 20% of people. And again, this differs from place to place. And for empowerment, a few people actually expressed a need for community mobilization and disabled people organization. And this actually has a voice. Say, for example, people need psychotropic medicines and it is not available in a particular facility. Okay. Or people need specific schemes for persons with mental illness. When the psychiatrists actually go and then express the need to the district collector or maybe even to the district health officer, it has a particular voice. But when a group of parents or persons with mental illness come together, form a federation, and they write a letter to the district collector that we people with mental illness or we are caregivers, according to the Mental Health Care Act and Rehabilitation Act, we are entitled to certain rights, but in our community we are not getting, please do the needful. Then actually it is taken more seriously because they have a right and they are actually asking for the right. And once it is documented, the concerned officer becomes liable because they have to show what is the action which they have actually taken. So here people coming together for organizations and even writing a letter, it actually has the capability of setting forward a big movement, or it has a ripple effect in terms of what actually happens. So a lot of people also came up with the need for having self-help groups. And interestingly, in rural areas, a lot of self-help groups actually run for females rather than males. So mostly females are considered to be more responsible. They take care of the child. And when you actually take hold of a mother and then empower her, it is considered that the entire family gets empowered. So a lot of government schemes are also given for females. And when it comes for political participation, interestingly, as compared to the urban areas, in the rural area, the political participation is much higher. And in our experience, we spoke to our patients. So during the last election in the Karnataka, almost everyone, even people who we thought were totally psychotic, we found that they had actually voted in the last election. So this is the need which we actually found in Jaglur, and what was the way that we actually started. So the way we started is, the NIMHANS team cooperated with a local NGO, which is the Association of People with Disability, which has a legacy of more than 60 kids. We had a meeting with the district health officer. We coordinated with the DMHP program. We sensitized the PHC medical officers. We worked with the ASHA workers. We evolved a camp schedule. We actually visit all these healthcare centers. Initially, we used to carry medicines with us, which was sponsored by Chitra Sanjeevani Charitable Trust from Infosys Foundation. And over a period of time, we have actually come to a position where the PHC is able to intense psychotropic medicines, which is given by government of Karnataka, and we are able to run the camps with this. So this was made possible by the input from different stakeholders. Say, there are government organizations, including the government of Karnataka, with special credit to Department of Health and Family Welfare, NIMHANS, and NGOs, which include Association of People with Disability, the Livlavla Foundation, which is actually funding the Association of People with Disability to run this program, not only for Jagalur Taluk, they are also covering several other taluks within the same district and other districts in Karnataka also. And Chitta Sanjeevani Charitable Trust, which provides free medications, psychotropic medications, for such community programs. And these medications are given free of cost. So this has been our experience, and we have also published our experience of the impact it has had. I would like to draw your attention on out-of-pocket expenditure. So we actually took a sample of 107 patients with severe mental illness and found out where they were availing services before coming to our CBR program. So this is the breakup. So on an average, people were spending about Rs. 14,100 per patient. So remember, all of them are poor. Most of them are below poverty line. And 99% of them had actually taken a loan to come to this, get this particular funds and then avail it. And after coming to this community-based rehabilitation program, the psychiatrist fee and medication fee had actually come down. And the amount of money which they spent on travel came down drastically. We had actually calculated a loss of wage of about 200 rupees per visit. Because for many people, we give a 3-month follow-up. And if there is anything, then our community staff also goes for home visits and then follow them up. So we found out from about 14,100 on average, out-of-pocket expenditure came down to about Rs. 500 rupees. And the biggest component which actually came down was medicines. And people were spending about overall, about 107 people, they spent nearly 10 or 11 lakhs for medicines. And once they came to our CBR program, the money which we had to spend for these people came to less than 1 lakh. So it actually means, as a psychiatrist, or when we procure medicines at bulk, or when the government of Karnataka procures, we are able to procure medicines at 1/10 of the cost which people buy when they have to buy it from a retail pharmacy. So this actually contributes to a lot of savings when it comes to people. And by this program, we were also able to cater to several people who actually couldn't go to a tertiary facility or a private facility to avail treatment. So there are a lot of people who were there at the homes, but they did not have the means, or the family members could not understand how to take them to a psychiatrist. So when we did home visit, we started people on treatment. It was difficult in the beginning, but with a few visits, we were able to ensure, like certain strategies was giving medicine to the family member and ensuring that the medicine injection, a depot injection, is given by the village health nurse, or that olanzapine tablet is given daily to this particular patient whenever they're actually possible. In some cases, even a single depot preparation of flufenazine, we have seen that it has produced a miraculous change where the person actually became more organized, became more amenable, and we were able to start this person on oral antipsychotics. The other experience which we had was about involving ASHAs. So we actually trained ASHAs about mental illness. We told them about common symptoms of mental illness and requested them, we are coming to our community. We are coming to the PHC. Please bring patients in your locality. We will offer treatment free of cost. If patients are unable to come, please let us know. We will come to your homes and start treatment. And we applied a scale called community attitude towards mental illness and studied it after about 18 months. So after 1.5 years, we found that the attitude of ASHA workers towards persons with mental illness, there was a dramatic change. Many people actually started believing that people with mental illness can be productive, that they are not unproductive members, they become better with treatment. So these are certain findings which we have published in Asian Journal of Psychiatry, and we have given this particular reference. So again, I would like to draw your attention on the best practices of NGOs in certain other initiatives. In this regard, MS Chalamutu Trust has some local initiatives on livelihood. We have about 23 self-help groups, which is run by patients with mental illness and their caregivers. So they have combined caregivers as well as patients, and they form self-help groups in different areas. Like they run a bakery, they run a laundry, they run a grocery store. They have actually funded loans for certain people to start ventures of their own. Like during our field visits, we have found a family which had actually set up a fancy store with the help of loans which was given by this particular, which was given by a bank, but the NGO actually acted as a collateral. So they ensure that if this particular person is unable to pay, we will pay. So it is at this context that the bank had given the loan. And when underprivileged people take these loans, the government actually has schemes. The interest rate is pretty low, and they also get a waiver. Like if it is sufficient that they even repay 75% of the original amount, they get concession. And the government also gives schemes like housing schemes. Like many of us are actually not aware about it. In a rural area, a person with disability can actually even get, if they have a land in their own name. So the money is released in four installments. One for doing the basement and once after the wall is built for sealing of the roof and for plastering of the entire house. So many people with disabilities, once they have the right connections, and it is also important to sensitize people. Many people are not aware that these schemes exist. And even when these schemes exist, we need to sensitize the concerned policymakers that these make it available for this particular person so that they can benefit. So once we do that, it is difficult, but it is possible with sustained effort to get some of these initiatives on. And some of these initiatives, like the MS Chalamuthu Trust in Madurai, they have been successful in running this program with funding from Andhra Hilfi from Germany. There are a lot of other organizations which also get funds from certain corporates in terms of yearly grants. Like we refer to Chitta Sanjeevani Charitable Trust, which gives free psychotropic medication. So Info Foundation has given 3 crores money as an endowment. So with the interest which comes from it, they're able to give medications. So this is just an example of that when the intention is in the right place, then we are able to find the sources of money to address some of these needs. And when it comes to like Mental Health Action Trust, I think that in certain places, they are also able to get the goodwill of people from local corporates who are willing to fund their vehicle travel because they have to travel all the way from Calicut till Wayanad, even to the interior areas, to the tribal areas, and then offer treatment. So people are able to cater to a lot of these needs, but it actually depends on the needs of this particular population. So in certain cases, livelihood may be a need. In certain cases, livelihood may not be a need. So it differs from place to place. So there are also some important publications which you can actually refer to. So this is this landmark paper by Dr. Jagdisha in 2009. So it is a community sample where people with psychosis, they were identified in the community. They were started on antipsychotics. And there is a long-term comparison of how their disability score in IDS actually fell over a period of time. So we were able to show that when people are started on medications, then the disability actually comes down. And when treatment is provided in the community by a social worker, a medical social worker who is trained and is able to handle an entire taluk, many people with schizophrenia in rural South India, they are actually able to function. So this was demonstrated in the second paper. And despite treatment being provided in the rural community, there are many people who actually remain out of treatment because of complex reasons, which includes personal reasons or the certain reluctance that the person may never improve, or the fact that maybe there may be a family property, or because of gender-related reasons. So the reasons are pretty diverse. So even though we go to the community, we offer services with all these stakeholders, so there is going to be a proportion of population who remain out of treatment. So this particular issue has been studied in the first and second paper by Shanivar Mitty and Dr. Naveen. And recently, in the year 2019, I think this particular paper has spoken about income generation programs where people with schizophrenia, they themselves had gotten in touch with local self-help groups, Manjunatha Sangha and several other agencies, and started availing some of these facilities to cater to their livelihood needs. So people may be interested in referring to some of these papers. And when you actually Google community-based rehabilitation Google Scholar, you are likely to come up with these three landmark studies by Sudipto Chatterjee. The first two studies, it was in a rural community in Madhya Pradesh, where they started working with NGO, which was initially working for leprosy. So by word of mouth, they got patients. Monthly camps were conducted, free medicines were given, and livelihood initiatives were also initiated. So in the first paper, they actually showed that people were coming for treatment and people were retaining well. And in the second paper, they showed that the IDS score actually came down with regular treatment. So it showed that when we actually go to the community, and we offer programs in association with various stakeholders, things actually work. So the COPSI study, they had three different arms, but the results were not statistically significant, but there was a trend line difference between both the groups when it came to this. And this is a very interesting paper with also open access. So we would strongly recommend that you actually go through it. So the group of researchers by Dr. Tara and Dr. Padmavati had shared their experience in a rural area in Tamil Nadu, where they had actually set up a CBR program, including a caregiver group, livelihood initiatives, and then they had to withdraw because of a lack of funds. So when they followed the same area after a few weeks, they found that everything had collapsed. So they actually concluded that it is important to work with all the stakeholders, including the family, health professionals, and the families also need a periodic hand-holding mental health professionals, otherwise things actually collapse. So real-life experience is actually somewhat pretty close to this. And the WHO has come up with the CBR guidelines. So it contains various documents. So it is free to download. So you Google WHO CBR. So the first link which comes is this. And you can actually download it, all these documents in English. I have about more than 5 documents. People who are interested can actually go through this particular document. So I would like to say that the most important hurdle is actually not in the purse. So money is available. Once the intention is well, we go and then we start working. We have found, and this is the experience shared by others, resources do come. So the only thing is that we may not have a ready-made resource when we actually go. We need to go, we need to start working, the resources do come. So the attitudinal barrier is most important. It's not the financial barrier or other things. So this is our journal, which comes from the Psychiatric Rehabilitation Services, 6th year of publication from Springer. So please consider it for submitting your articles. Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Nitin here from Hyderabad. So I would like to know about the sustainability of the program. So now the NGOs are running it. So what after, say, 5 or 10 years of the program?
Yeah. The thing is that, like, according to the WHO CBR, it has to be run the resources from various stakeholders. They do not necessarily say that the government has to provide a regular fund and with that you do it. Because the underlying concept here is that every community has resources. It is only a question of understanding who has the resources, convincing them, and then getting that. So to run any program, we need money. So if you are able to run a program, then we will be able to arrange funds from different people and then continue that particular program. It can be corporate, it can be donations raised by few patients, or it can be some amount of money which is periodically given by the government. So yes, funding is an issue. So it is an ongoing effort, but that is how things go. And from our experience, we have seen that different organizations, they are able to sustain over a period of time. But hunt for funds and ensuring the financial viability, it is an ongoing issue. It is a challenge. Like, for example, running a hospital, even a tertiary care government hospital, the government gives ready-made funds. But for a community-based rehabilitation program, we may not get such an allotted money. But an easier way is like tying up with the local people or with the local governmental organization and try to get medicines maybe free of cost. Or tie up with the private medical college hospital and find out if the particular psychiatrist in the residence can actually come there and conduct once in a month camp. So that particular aspect also becomes free. Maybe for the social worker, we have to pay some 15,000, 20,000, whether that money can be arranged through some particular grants. Whether the case finding can actually be taken by a recovered person with mental illness who can coordinate people with mental illness and other families in his locality at least once in a month or once in 2 months to come for a regular camp. So actually, it does not cost as much money as it costs to even run an OPD in a tertiary care hospital for a single day. The costs which are required is actually pretty less. For example, at Jaglur, the amount of cost which is required to run this program, which actually we incur for our travel and for the staff cost, is only about 3 lakhs. So with this, we are actually able to cater to about 300, 400 people and ensure that they are on treatment for the entire year. So this is just a rough estimate which I'm giving you. So if this entire 300 people, they were to come for a tertiary care facility, buy medicines and do it, of course, the cost which they will be incurring will be much higher. So this is a finding which we saw in our study. So just for this 100 people, which we included in that, they themselves had saved more money than the amount of money which we spent to run this program. So that was one of the key findings, which is again what WHO says. If you go closer to the base of the pyramid, the cost incurred is less and you'll be able to cater to more people.
Thank you for participating in today's program. We also thank Dr. Sivakumar sir for taking this session. And we also would like to place on record our sincere thanks to Linux Laboratories for their support through educational grant.